A metric gives us a measure of the distance between two elements in a set. The definition states that a real-valued function d of x and y is a metric on the set x if, and if with two f's is often used in definitions, and it means if and only if. So if and only if, for all elements x, y, and z in the set x, capital X, it satisfies the following four conditions. And when stating these conditions, I will call the function d the distance function to add some intuition to the definition. So a metric gives the distance between two elements in a set. So we have two elements, one we may call x and the other one we may call y, and d gives the distance between these. The first condition states that the distance between two elements has to be positive or zero. And the distance between an element and itself, so the distance from x to x, is identically zero. And this is complemented by the next condition, which states that the only time the distance is zero is when you measure the distance between an element and itself. So if the distance is zero, then that means that x equals y. From the conditions m1 and m2 together, we see that the distance between two different elements, that is, when x is not equal to y, this distance has to be positive, strictly positive. Third, the distance function has to be symmetric. That is, if we measure the distance from x to y, then this has to be the same as the distance from y to x. And finally, the distance function has to satisfy the triangle inequality. What the triangle inequality says is that if you go from x to y through an intermediate point, let's call this z, then the total distance going first from x to z and then going from z to y, this total distance is always larger than or equal to the distance going directly from x to y. If you need to brush up on the triangle inequality or on any other mathematics that we use here, you may, for instance, have a look at Khan Academy. On the set of all n-dimensional vectors with real-valued elements, Rn here, we have several alternative ways of measuring the distance between two elements. The one you are most used to is probably the Euclidean metric. Let us consider the space of two-dimensional vectors, since this is easy to illustrate. The elements are two-dimensional vectors. We have a vector x. This has two elements, x1 and x2. So meaning that we have x1 here, x2 here. And then we have another vector y, which has elements y1 and y2, meaning that we have y1 here, and we have y2 up here. When we use the Euclidean metric, then we first take the absolute value of x1 minus y1, which is the length of the line segment here. And we square this. So we take the length of this line segment and we square it. And then we take the absolute value of x2 minus y2, which is the length of the line segment here. And we also square this. We add these two and take the square root. And by Pythagoras, we know that the result is the length of the straight line connecting x and y. So the Euclidean metric is the length of this line segment. The Euclidean metric can be generalized, however, to the p-metric. Instead of squaring each of these differences, we raise it to the power p. And we add this, and then we take the pth root of this sum. And this can be done for any value of p from 1 up to infinity. Say, for instance, that we choose p equal to 1. Then we get this metric here. We can illustrate also this in R2. the distance between the elements x and y is the absolute value of x1 minus y1, which is the length of this line segment here, plus the absolute value of x2 minus y2, which is the length of this line segment here. So the distance measured by the D1 metric is the sum of the length of these two line segments. D1 is often called the taxicab metric or the Manhattan metric because this is the distance you would have to drive to get from point X to point Y in a city with a square grid of streets. When P goes to infinity, we obtain the D infinity metric. And this is simply the difference between XI and yi that has the largest absolute value. In the two-dimensional case, it is the length of the longest line segment. So in this example, it would be the length of this line segment here, because we see that this is longer than this line segment here. The reason for this is that we raise these differences to the power of p. And when p becomes really large, then the largest difference will totally dominate all the others when we sum them up. So the sum will be the largest difference raised to the power p, and then we take the pth root of this, and we are left with the maximum difference itself. When it comes to the set of all real-valued continuous functions on a to b, also here we have several alternative metrics corresponding to p-values from 1 up to infinity. The distance between two functions measured by the general p-metric is defined by integrating the absolute value, or the difference between these two functions, raised to the power p. We integrate from a to b, and then we take the pth root. Take for instance the 1 metric, d1, measuring the distance between the functions f and g. And say that the two functions look something like this. This is f as a function of time t, so it is the time along this axis here. And then we have the function g. And the absolute value or the difference between these two functions at some time, let's call it tau, would be the length of this line segment here. And when we integrate this from a to b, we get the area between these two functions. So this area here is the distance measure given by the D1 metric. If we let p go to infinity, a similar thing happens as we discussed earlier. Then, since we raise the length of each of these line segments here to the power p, then the largest one will totally dominate the others when we sum them up, like we do when we integrate. And when we afterward take the pth root of this, we are left with this maximum value. So the infinity metric is the length of the longest line segment, which in this example would be approximately this. So this is d infinity of f and g. To relate this to what we have learned earlier about spaces, we have here seen two examples of sets that have the topological structure of a metric defined on them. We have defined the p-metric of the set of all n-dimensional vectors with real-valued components. And we have defined another p-metric on the set of all real-valued continuous functions on a to b. For both of these metrics, they are defined for any value of p ranging from 1 to infinity. And the metrics allow us to measure the distance between two elements in the set. By the definition of spaces, we then have that these sets, together with any of the p metrics, are metric spaces.